What's up guys, this is Balázs from Racing Brick. The Crocodile Locomotive was officially released yesterday, so it was not a big surprise to see a new version of the powered up app as well. Apart from the train controls, there are a few promising items on the release notes, so let's have a look. So there's a new controller for the Crocodile Locomotive, some fixes for the Haunted House, and the most important for me, two new coding blocks for improved servo steering. Let's start with the good things, the controller for the Crocodile train. As you see here, the interface has a really nice and polished design. The wheel at the center regulates the speed, it works smoothly in both directions, and it does not have an end stop. If you are more familiar with controls of a locomotive, then please let me know in the comments if this is authentic or not. The lever on the right is the brake, so the speed control and the brake is actually separated. It is possible to start the locomotive slowly and smoothly, or we can also set the brake, adjust the speed, and then release the brake for a quicker start. The locomotive can be also stopped immediately with the red stop button in the top right corner. We also get the usual sound effects with these three buttons. Apart from the speed gauges, there's a counter that shows our distance traveled, and it can be reset with the red button, but it also goes back to zero if we use the stop button. So, officially the profile works with the AAA hub and the Technical motor. The other train profiles were very picky with the connections as well. It only worked with the motor plugged in the appropriate port. Apparently this one is less strict, the motor works in both A and B ports. Now let's see if we could use another type of motor. The Technic XL motor is not the best choice as it would not fit in the locomotive easily, but it's good for the test. As you see, the profile validates the motor type and the XL motor won't run, unfortunately. The powered up medium motor would be a better potential replacement, but that one does not work either with the stock profile. Of course, with a little coding, we can make it work in the coding area, but then we lose the sound effects and the other features. Now let's have a look at the interface on the iPad. We've seen some weird layouts on the iPad previously, like the joystick interface of the coding canvas, and apparently this one suffers from the same issue. The size of the control elements seems to be fixed, and they look very funny on the large screen. Actually, they are even smaller than on my phone, which kind of eliminates all the potential advantages of the tablet with the bigger screen. I hope the developers will fix this and we'll get an updated version that scales properly. So that was the train part, now let's have a look at the brand new coding blocks that's supposed to improve the servo steering. Well, here they are. The first thing to notice is the weird shape. Apparently this new type of block runs by itself, either by tapping on it or by starting the whole program with the play button. Let's see what the first one does. It is actually a calibration sequence that works the same way as the calibration in the Control Plus app. It measures the two endpoints of the steering and sets relative zero position in the middle. It is possible to change the value from zero, then the center point will be adjusted based on the value. Now let's see the other block, which is a mystery for me. It can be used to set the speed of the motor and that's all. Due to the weird shape, it is running constantly, so any changes in the values will have an immediate effect. Actually, with a few blocks, this behavior can be replicated. The simple speed regulator block will not update the speed on the fly, but if we add a loop, then we'll get the exact same functionality. So, what's the advantage of the new block? Honestly, I don't know. Let's go back to the calibration block and run a few more tests. As you see, if there's nothing blocking the motor, then it simply runs without stopping. It requires physical endpoints for the calibration. Let's create a simple blocking mechanism with a few pieces that will limit the range of motion. I also added a block that shows the relative position value in real time. If I run the calibration now, you can see how the relative position changes. The block actually resets the value to zero at one end, measures the degree of rotation until the other endpoint, then sets the relative zero in between them. And here's an annoying thing with the block that makes me wonder why it was designed this way. When you run the calibration block, then after the process is completed, it still actively holds the position, and it only releases when the program sequence is stopped. This means that it is not possible to integrate the calibration in a bigger program. It always needs to be executed on its own and then deleted. I really have no idea why it couldn't be a regular block that could be triggered with a button or any other command. It makes it far less useful, and I can't imagine any advantages at the moment that would justify this design. Now let's see if the relative zero position has any relationship with the absolute zero position. The L and XL motors have an internal absolute zero position that is quite useful, but unlike the Spy Prime motors, it is not marked on them. With a limited but symmetrical range, the central position will still be around the 0 or 90 degrees position, so in theory the block could still actually use the absolute zero that falls in the range of motion. If I use these pins to set a custom motion range, then the middle position will be around 45 degrees here. That still leaves us with some hope, but a few additional tests actually proved that the block only divides the range of motion in half and does not use the absolute zero. Let's see if the calibration works with the XL motor as well. As you see, the result is similar, but with a more powerful motor we face another flaw of the calibration block. It uses full speed or full power to push the endpoints. That means the endpoint and the axle will be stressed unnecessarily, and as you see, my cross block actually flies away. An adjustable power parameter would be very handy for the calibration block. So, did we really get improved steering with the update? Unfortunately, I don't think so. If we check my custom control code, then a single calibration line was replaced with a new block, but it's not even a proper replacement since the calibration block cannot be triggered with a command or a button. It has to be executed on its own. As you see, there's still a whole bunch of things necessary for a proper vehicle control, especially for steering, and we still don't have a simple solution for that. The lack of access to the absolute zero position is still the biggest pain point, and I won't even mention the customizable controls. This update only added very few useful pieces to the big powered up puzzle, and without knowing the intentions of the developers with the new blocks, it's even more difficult to use them properly. Let's hope the improved communication that was promised earlier this year will have some visible effect, and we'll get more features and especially more information going forward. If you like this video, then please give it a thumbs up, you can also subscribe, and tap the notification bell if you don't want to miss my technic reviews and other LEGO RC videos. See you next time, bye bye!